most of the presentation will be in English. I'm also a settler to this place. So I'm a proud husband and I'm a proud father. And currently I'm a graduate student in math education at NDSU. And I've been partnering with City School College and also the Virgin Nest. And recently I've been hired as a math faculty and teacher head faculty at Turtle Mountain Community College. So that's a little bit of me. Good Blue Sunshine, and all the time, maybe you want to introduce yourself.
Between all four of these ideas, and as well as
And so they can grow together. And there's a balance as well between the Western map, English, and the Dakota map, Dakota. And so that's kind of all a part of the model. And at the center, so this little blue diamond at the center, if you can see that, that's what we call Lakota map connections. And so that's kind of the connecting point. And part of the research question is just trying to understand these connections. But the goal is that as we were talking to map instructors at tribal colleges who were in the Western map system, but the tribal college goals and their goals were wanting to connect what they had to teach in a Western map course to language and culture. And then also for language instructors teaching Lakota or Dakota, connecting it to other things, English, Western map, and Lakota map. And so the hope is that by understanding this connection point, it could be beneficial for everyone. And our assumption with this model is that we would be able to kind of find that connecting point between all four of these spaces. And so for me, like I said, I'm trained as a mathematician, and so I very much, like, my strengths are in the Western math and English. And so when I kind of began this, I very much was thinking on that side of the Venn diagram. But through that kind of circulating conversations with Sunshine and Josh and others, the first thing that came up was like, well, this idea of Lakota map, like there's mathematical ways of knowing that aren't shown or demonstrated in the map classroom, the current, that are really the colonized or Western map classroom. And so we added that to the model. Then we had kind of these three circle Venn diagram. And as we began using it, we saw an assumption that the diagram was in English. I'd like to, at one point, see this diagram in Lakota also, but for now it's in English. And so there was, all of these came into the play. And so for me, when the Lakota map came, that was in the map department at NDSU and just in the general map field of other mathematicians, making the argument that there is a Lakota map that is distinct and able to stand on its own. Yes, it can connect to the Western map that we learn in the American education system, but it is distinct. And the kind of key example that kind of came up early for me was this idea that numbers can be seen as verbs. That it's not just a noun of being three or abstract quantity of three, but this idea that you can be three or being three instead of just an abstract quantity. And so there was part of this for me has been kind of arguing in the, I don't know, arguing is the right word, but sharing in the my math the department and other places that Lakota map exists and can stand on its own. And now I'm going to ask Sunshine. That's something that I've kind of experienced within the math department, but how does this work connect to you and how is it valuable?
It might be a little loud.
That's all good.
Yeah. Lecture Georgie, so I think whenever Lecture Danny approached us approached me, he was actually referred through one of my old elementary teachers, Kathy Braylett. And so she knew that we were having our immersion school here. In City Bowl. She used to be an education faculty here, and she connected with Danny and thought that we would be able to be a resource for each other. And when I met Danny, was really excited because I don't always know how we're supposed to do things. I don't always know what the plan is. The only thing that I know is we lead with prayer, and our kids guide us. And whatever we need, if we ask for it, it will come. And so when Danny had come and said he wants to know if there's any way that we could connect in looking at math and looking at Lakota and Lakota language and schools and teaching, Respect to language conference. One of the things over the years working in tribal ed and working with our local language teachers in mainstream schools, we have a lot of times they say, well, we're doing math. We're doing, when you put up a TV, that's a higher order math. When you're, when we're doing Lakota art, that's higher order math. And we know that. We know the things that we do, that's engineering, that's science. And Linda Blackbelt does a really good job in like making the connections to the science world and how what we have done traditionally before there was ever a classroom was already higher order math, science, engineering, astronomy, all of those things. But making the connection to the Western world is what I think Danny brings, because we can show what our kids are doing and what they know how to do. This last week, our older kids went and built Earth Lodge for the new school that's coming. And there's a ton of math when you're doing that. What kind? That's Danny's job. You explain to them. You make that connection to them about what we do and what we know. And we're going to do it, and our kids will be well ready for the world in Lakota and in the mainstream society. And we, being able to show what we do and what we've always done is of the highest level is important, but it's not our main focus, which is why Danny's important. He can say, yes, what they're doing is this, this, and this. And we can just be knowing what we've always known. So that's, partnering with Danny and looking at, for us, the focus is more on Lakota math than Lakota. What things do we do? How did we do them? How did we describe them when we were doing math in Lakota? That's the focus for us. The Western math and the English, that's the connection we're making. That's the resource that Danny uses. He knows all the math stuff. He knows all the terms. I think it was funny to see the different levels he'll talk about when we had our summer institute. But, Malcolm, do you want to add anything to that?
A lot of the stuff that we're talking about was done in the Lakota way a long time ago. And they just didn't know what it was called back then. But once we got talking to Danny, we made up words and even put the math in gear. With everything goes where, and it was very interesting for us, because Daniel gave us a lot of knowledge and things that we work with. So that's the part of the instructions that we work with.
They mentioned the course, and so we're going to share about that next. During DLSI this past year, we had a Lakota Math Connections course, and the design there was actually part of the course, and trying, can we articulate the mathematical thinking and the mathematical knowledge that is evident had to be known and used to make a design like that. So the course itself was a week long and kind of focused on bringing together three groups of people. It was kind of coming together of fluent elders, language instructors and learners, and then tribal college math faculty. And the idea was like, if we bring these three groups, and there were other people as well, there were some science instructors and just community members as well. But we bring these, connect questions about math, Western math, Dakota math, like what happens? And one of the questions is like, was it beneficial for everyone? Was it beneficial for the Tribal College math faculty? Was it beneficial for the immersionist? Was it beneficial for the immersionist? Elders see it as valuable as well. And so that was part of the question of like, this course and this idea, is it going to be beneficial? And so we kind of had a schedule for the week. And if you'll notice, so just 5 days, in the middle column, you'll see these universal math activities. So one of the kind of research bases that we're building on is this idea called ethnomathematics, which says in every language and people, there's these six universal math activities of explaining, counting, designing, locating, measuring, and playing. And that those can be, those are mathematical activities. And then we looked at a particular topic, either the number system or just the significance of a circle, a total star knowledge, archery, and hand game, and try to make that connection and then be able to articulate the math that was happening within that. And so this really all, pretty much the whole course built from a dissertation done about 10 years earlier by Dave Sanders. He grew up in Oglala and then did his research as well at a middle school in Oglala, Longman Day School. And so it's called Mathematical Views Within a Recovered Community Towards a Mathematics for Tribal Self-Determination. And so his work, both interviewing elders in his community and also kind of archival research, kind of showed us a lot about Lakota math. One thing that he was able to do, and that we used in the course was just these tables of Lakota words for different math ideas. And so here's one of the tables. I just took a screenshot of it from the course and what he did. And this is what he found when he was working in Oglala. And the thing that I noticed is that perhaps these are not all the same words that you have seen for these different numbers. And I was like, that's completely okay. There's a richness in multiple words for the same idea. And so, for example, like in English, when you say 1,000, there's other words to say 1,000. You can say a gram, you can say a kilo, because if you want to say it short, like a thou, you know, or 1,000 years is a millennium. And so there's multiple ways to say 1,000, and that's totally fine. And so when I saw this and started learning the numbers, but also the structure of the numbers was really what like caught my attention right away. And so specifically if you look at 135, you see that structure of the sum in between the three values that are added together. And so that additive structure immediately, for me, connected to series and partial sums in Calculus 2. And so we won't go into all the details of series and partial sums in Calculus 2, but that structure is the same. And so I think the best is maybe just an example. So if you look at the number 1,653,248 in Lakota, that would be said or written as far as we know as this. I'm not going to read it all out, but one of the things that I've heard kind of people say is like, oh, you can't count to 1,000,000 in Lakota in one day. And then when I say, like, who cares? Who cares? Like, when was the last time anyone counted to 1,000,000 in English? But what you notice in the words is the sum between each place value. And so you might, this could also be seen as like 1,000,000 plus 100,000 times 6 plus 100,000 times 5 plus 100,000 or 1,000 times 3 plus 100 times 2 plus 10 times 4 plus 8. And similarly to like polynomials, that emphasize. And so, I'm not going to focus on polynomials, but the connection to polynomials is there too, which I find very interesting. But here, that additive structure is exactly what we see in partial sums. And so, if I were to translate this into what I'd say a partial sum would be, this would be, you'd say, like, this is the seventh number plus the sixth number plus the fifth number plus the fourth number plus the third plus the second number plus the first number. And in calculus, we would write that as a summation of the index from 1 to 7. And so I'm not saying that this is like a one-to-one correspondence, like this is that partial sums were the exact thing that's here, but I'm saying the higher order kind of concept and the structure of the number system is the same in both places. And so I think that just to see that higher order mathematical thinking that we use in calculus too is the exact same, is that additive structure. And so this is one example. There was another example that got me like very excited to learn more. And I call it that one example, because I think that's funny. So that one example, I understand the three words that we use for one, Wangxi, Wangji, and Wang, being like a counting one, a hypothetical one, and a realized one. And so English actually doesn't have this kind of variation of understanding different types of ones. And so I'm going to take you through an example. When adding fractions, trying to explain it in English because of the not having this three different words for one is actually more messy in English. And using understanding Lakota language, and specifically the fluency of like these three words, will make learning fractions, and especially like adding fractions, easier. So I want to show you this example. So if you're adding 2/3 and 1/4, the first thing that whenever you're adding fractions is that denominator, so the number on the bottom, needs to be the same. And that's like the cardinal rule of adding fractions, that denominators have to be the same. And so you're looking for what's called the least common denominator. And how you do that is you multiply both fractions by one. But you don't really know what kind of one. It's not sure. And often before this, I'm talking about it's like a special one. And I kind of fumbled around English trying to be able to explain this. But you're multiplying it by one. But if it's a particular, you don't know what one it is yet, it's this hypothetical, it's a one, you know you need to multiply it by some one. And on this part, you know the denominator needs to be 12, so what is that hypothetical, what does that become? And over here you need 12 again in the denominator, so it becomes a realized one when you have determined that that one is actually needs to be 4 over 4. And then on this term, that one, that hypothetical one, needs to become like a realized one in the sense of 3 over 3. And so right there, you translate from a hypothetical one to a realized one in the adding of fractions. And that's like the critical component of adding fractions, of knowing what to multiply to make that common denominator. And so when you finish the problem, the multiplication goes across, you have 2 over 4, 2 times 4 over 3 over 4, plus 1 times 3 over 4 times 3, and that becomes 8 over 12 plus 3 over 12, and now that the denominators are the same, you can add the numerators together, and you have 11 over 12. And so this idea of a hypothetical realized one makes, I think it's a perfect example of where math fluency and language fluency can grow together. And Lakota being a better suited for teaching addition of fractions, I think, than English can be because of this three different words for one. The third example that I want to share, I'm going to ask Lala Tom to share a short story, if he's willing, of one of his family members, if he's able.
Yeah, the story I told was that one of my rickshaws, my uncle's, when he gets up in the morning, especially in the winter time, he would mark the sunrise on the wall of the log house to see which way the sun is going. And that's how he knows what kind of day it's going to be. I don't know how, I never really asked him how he knows what he was doing, but I seen him do it that way. That's how he knows what kind of day it's going to be, I guess. It was very interesting later on when I grew older and I thought about that. I should have asked him what he was doing, because I would like to know too if he calculates that. That's my story. Get on my head.
That's the line that I mentioned. So each mark would be maybe a day. And at the winter solstice, the sun's movement along the horizon would actually halt. And then the sun would start moving back or the left of the horizon, or the north of the north along the horizon. And then in the summer, the sun actually each day would move a further distance along the horizon. And so this idea that a lot of times uncle was able to mark where the sun was rising, if he certainly would have been able and did determine the solstice and the equinox, winter, summer, spring and fall, exactly when those are, based upon those marking. And so he is a mathematical idea that he was drawing, maybe, or plotting in three dimensions. So if you translate this sun wave as it moves along the horizon in 1 year, it actually plots to the two-dimensional sine wave, which comes up in both, starts in trigonometry and then is in every math course after trigonometry. And so you can see that, let's say, right here, and this is in degrees, they can almost think of it as days, right here would be the winter solstice, where the sun changes directions. Every morning, as it moves along the horizon, it's moving further south, and then at the winter solstice, it halts and reverses direction back up the horizon. And then this would be the spring equinox, and then at the summer solstice, the exact same thing happens. It slows down its movement along the horizon, and then it halts and changes direction. And so this, and I don't know certainly that Lecce was thinking of the mathematical idea of a sine wave, but he certainly was plotting a sine wave based upon where the sun rose on the horizon. And so that nobody asked for research papers. You know, like that wasn't what was interested. Now I will have to write some research papers because I am working towards my PhD. But I still need to do that. So there were two things that were specifically asked for, and those are going to be kind of the next steps that we look at. And so the first next step is some sort of reference guide, not curriculum. And so that came because there was science teachers, there was math teachers, language instructors, from immersion level to tribal college level. And like there's just this huge range, like there's no way we could design curriculum for that variety of instructors. So that's an issue. But the other thing is that if it's place-based, you have a math instructor and language instructor at Sittingbull College or another place within the Dakota country, like the curriculum, if it's place-based, I can't just hand the curriculum. So this idea of some sort of reference guide came up, and that was encouraging because the Maori in New Zealand, they also have a math dictionary type idea, and so I'm trying to look at that example as well. Some sort of reference guide that these different examples, these three examples, and hopefully more as we keep going, we'll be able to kind of be together in a particular place that instructors from anywhere, you know, the country can look at. And so we're hopefully going to be working on that coming forward. The other kind of main next step that we want to talk about and kind of invite you into is this kind of a three-pronged approach. And part of that came out because there was different groups that we were bringing together in this original course this last summer. But out of it came this three-pronged approach, and I put it on a electrical power outlet. That was funny. But this three-pronged approach is that the STEM, or the math faculty at Tyler College, saying we're interested, but we're looking for something that we would like to incorporate this into our algebra classroom, our geometry classroom, our calculus classroom, but we just need some more help doing that. We need some more PD is professional development. We need some more professional development in incorporating these kind of different connections that you were able to discuss and share into our particular classroom and lots of different math classes that are offered. And so that's kind of one prong of this three-pronged approach that we might look at going forward. The next prong would be this idea of like neologisms or developing new words. Some of those Lakota words could be first sine wave, for example, we just saw, or negative numbers, or potentially like multiplication. Something that I would be really interested in kind of seeing new words for is exponents, and how that might connect with reduplication within the language, and how that can relate to exponents. And I think there's a strong connection there. So the idea of developing new words for that both tribal college math instructors would be able to use, as well as those in the immersion school would be able to be used in their math curriculum. And then the third part of this kind of three-pronged approach that is maybe the most exciting for everyone is the idea that it's grounded in Lakota math, that we're not just trying to translate a textbook or teach Western math ideas in Lakota language. And that might be maybe a little more what the deal is. It's Western math ideas that we're going to be able to speak and share in Lakota language and in a Western math classroom. But the kind of key component of it all is that it's grounded in Lakota math, that can we better learn it in Lava Tongues? Sunway, for example, is maybe the closest to that, but can we, or we want to, particularly learn about Lakota math? Yeah? construction using proportionality instead of attainment, like using proportionality instead of tape measure for construction. Another idea within that is the calendar and understand how the calendar is calibrated between the sun and the moon and how that calibration goes. Games, whether it's a hand game or other games, all of these things demonstrate mathematical thinking or higher order mathematical thinking that was passed on with math education was passed along for generations, and we want to be able to learn and ask the question, like, how was it passed along, and what was that particular Lakota math ideas that were being passed from one generation to the next. And so that's this idea of Lakota math and not having to connect it to a Western math idea at all. And so these three together will hopefully benefit, like I said, the math instructors, the language instructors, and go forward. So we're potentially working on some efforts to kind of do all this three-pronged approach going forward with some grants and a few other things. But one thing that I want to just share is that kind of an invitation that if you are interested in Lakota math or in participating in a DLSI course this coming summer with any of these three kind of prongs and the teacher STEM teacher professional development and the new words, neologisms for potentially like negative number or things like that, or the part that made me very excited with the Lakota math standing on its own. So I put this QR code that if you want to, you can scan, or I put my email as well. There's just an open invitation to join as we kind of better understand Lakota math and articulate it and share it. So yeah, the QR code is just, it's just simply asking for your name and email and things like that. So we can stay connected and be reminding you of kind of upcoming events. I won't be spamming you or anything, but just reminding you of upcoming events kind of we're working on at DLSI or elsewhere related to the program. And so, is there any questions or discussions? I just want to close and say in English, I want to say thank you. Choctaw, I'll say Yakoke, and Lakota, Columbia. Thank you.
These guys can sing a song all the way. When I alone in here, I hear you asking, Aku and Lee and Chiha. If I na Shina Chicho, like Chidani.
Yeah.
Yeah, it goes to Google Drive and then it says you need permission only by the view, or this form can only be viewed by users in the owner's organization.
So it sounds like I messed that up then.
Doksha, kaya wachi ang topic de?
Doksha, kaya wachi ang topic?